A very warm good morning to all of you. Dear students, once again, I would like to welcome all of you to a new session of the civics class. Today, we are going to begin with a new chapter, chapter number 2, The President and the Vice President, Part 1. In this chapter, we are going to study about the powers and functions of the President and Vice President of our country. As you all know, we have a President and Vice President in our country, and they have got a number of responsibilities, powers, and they are functioning for the well-being of our nation. So let's see some of the main specialities and features of our President. The executive power of India is vested with the President, or in other words, all the executive powers of our nation is given to the President of our country, and he exercises this power either directly or through officers subordinated to him, which means there are a number of officers who are working under the President. Let's take one example. The governors of each state is directly functioning or working under the President. That's why the governors are being known as the representatives of the President. So, the President exercises all his executive powers either directly or through officers subordinated to him. And the third one, it says that President is the head of the state and the supreme commander of the defense forces of India. Head of the state means like king, if it is a king, he is the head of the kingdom. Same way, President is the head of the state, or in other words, he is the first citizen of our country and the supreme commander of the defense forces. Defense forces like Air Force, Navy and Army. All these three different defense forces are functioning directly under the President. That's why he is being known as the supreme commander of the defense forces of India. And the fourth one says that he exercises his powers on the advice of the Prime Minister and the Council of Ministers. So whenever the President wants to exercise his powers, he has to get the advice of the Prime Minister and the Council of Ministers, whatever the matters. So he will be functioning with the support of the Prime Minister and the Council of Ministers, because Prime Minister and the Council of Ministers are the representatives of the people. Since our country is a democratic nation, the President has to get the advice of the Prime Minister and the Council of Ministers. According to our Constitution, there shall be a Council of Ministers with the Prime Minister at the head to aid and advise the President in the exercise of his or her functions. What does it mean? In the Constitution of our country, it clearly says that the President must get advice from the Prime Minister as well as the Council of Ministers. So, for the smooth full functioning of the nation, the President has to consult, or he has to get the advice of the Prime Minister and the Council of Ministers. Now let's see what are the qualifications needed to become the President of India. First of all, a person shall be eligible for election as President if he is a citizen of India. First of all, the person or the candidate who is going to be elected as the President of India must be a citizen of India. Second one, he must have completed the age of 35 years. So the person must be 35 years of old. And the third one says that he must be qualified for election as a member of Lok Sabha. When we were discussing the first chapter of civics, that is Union Parliament, we have seen what were the different qualifications to be needed to become a member of Lok Sabha. So all those qualifications are needed. Along with those qualifications, the person must be a citizen of India, and second one, he must have completed the age of 35 years. So these are the different qualifications needed to be the President of India, or if then and there only a person shall be eligible for election as the President of India. So we were seeing how a person shall be eligible for election. Now let's see how a person shall not be eligible. If he holds any office or profit under the state or central government, which means he must not be an employee of the state or central government. Employee means in any of the offices of the state or central government. So that person cannot become a president or the president of our country. So if a person is holding any office, he will not be eligible. He shall not be eligible. So that is the only one criteria where a person cannot become the president of our country. And one more point is there, a person who holds or who has held office as the president shall be eligible for re-election, which means if you are the president of India right now, once when your term of office is over, you can stand for re-election. So that's the first one, a person who holds. And again, the second one says that who has held, which means if you were the president of India before 10 years, again you can stand for re-election now. So that's what this particular point says, a person who holds or a person who has held the office as president shall be eligible for re-election. But certain conditions are there according to the constitution of our country. So these were the different points related to the qualifications and disqualifications for election as the president of India. Now let's see how the election of the president takes place. The president of India is indirectly elected by the members of an electoral college. Let's see how is the composition of the electoral college. So as I have already told you right now, the president is elected indirectly. So the whole people of the nation have no role in the election of the president. But the representatives of the people are electing the president. That's why we are considering, or that's why we are saying that the president is elected indirectly by the people of the nation. And it is through a particular procedure which is being known as electoral college. So the members of an electoral college is electing the president of India. And it consists of the elected members of both houses of parliament. Second one, the elected members of the legislative assemblies of the states, including National Capital Territory of Delhi and the Union Territory of Pondicherry. But there is a speciality that nominated members of parliament and state assemblies are not eligible to cast their vote, or they are not the members of electoral college. Who are the nominated members? Do you remember when we were discussing about the Union Parliament? We have already seen to Lok Sabha, two people can be nominated by the president, and to Rajya Sabha, 12 people can be nominated by the president. And what are the specialities of these nominated members? They will be expert in some of the particular fields like literature, science, sports and so on. So those people are not eligible to cast their vote in the election of the president. Now we have seen who are the members electing the president of our country. Now let's see how the procedure will take place. Candidate will have to be proposed by 50 members of the electoral college. Suppose, just imagine, there are 500 members in the electoral college, and out of the 500 members, 50 members of the electoral college has to support, or they have to propose the candidate. Second one, and seconded by another 50 members. So the first 50 members, they proposed the name of the candidate, and again it must be supported by another 50 members. So altogether 100 members must support the candidate. So that's the first thing, or the first step in the election of the president of our country. Earlier the requirement was 10 proposals and 10 seconders, but it has got increased by an ordinance in 1997, and later it became an act of parliament on August 29th, 1997. So as per the new act, 50 people has to propose the candidate and it must be seconded by another 50 members. According to the Act of Parliament on August 29, 1997, the security deposit of the president candidate raised from 2,500 to 15,000. So it is also a part of this particular act, Act of Parliament 1997. The election of the president is held in accordance with the proportional representation, which means single transferable vote. And the particular method they have adopted, or in our country we are adopting, is secret ballot system. That means nobody will come to know to whom we have casted our vote. So these are the main features with regard to the composition of the electoral college. So dear students, here we are winding up today's class, and I hope that you have got a very clear picture about what we have studied today. And in the next class, we will be discussing about some other important factors related to the president. And I believe that you will complete all your works before the next class. So let's meet again in the next class with new informations. Still then, I would like to sign off. Thank you.